really overcomplicated sort of title. And so basically what I kind of view a digital method as is any sort of technology. Any piece of technology is considered digital methodology, right? And so, for example, web page, social media, phone and computer applications, videos, podcasts, you name it. If you plug it into a wall, you know, it requires electricity, things like that, it's technology. So what I wanted to do is see how a small grassroots organization like CESOS that is very community driven and based in the community, how they can use those methods to preserve their traditions, but also to advocate on behalf of them. And so to start, I had to go back to the CESOS framework, the CESOS vision, and this is their vision. The vision of CESOS is to become a leading and exemplary community-based and community-driven research and learning center that focuses on the intersections of land, water, and policy development. The mission of CESOS is to protect and preserve ways of life and traditions in the Valle de Atrisco through research, advocacy, education, and policy development. And so when I joined the Institute, I wanted to bridge that gap, bridge the gap between these progressive technologies that all of us are sort of forced into using on a daily basis and this community-driven, community-based research. And so this is what we do in CESOS, working to protect and preserve our communities. A big component is the battle against the San Bolina Master Plan and organizing. And so currently, CESOS is really, I would say, on the cutting edge of a lot of these technologies already. So for instance, they have Comunidad Presente, which is their podcast, which is an important source of sort of getting the message out. I know Alexandria, who is presenting after me, she played a big role in creating some of these podcasts, which brought in members of the community to give them a voice on the Esequias in the South Valley. There's also the CESOS Facebook page, which of course is an important social media tool. I mean, everyone's on social media nowadays. So that's an important tool to reach out and to advocate on behalf of the community. And then on the right, that is the that's a screenshot from the South Valley Regional Association of Esequias. So that website is currently in development, and I was fortunate enough to actually contribute a little bit to that website through just like a brief history of the Esequias, but also through the creation of what will hopefully be a digital archive. And I'll sort of explain that a little bit. So basically, I guess the next question is, you know, we have all these technologies that organizations like CESOS use. Is it effective? And I think it is effective. One way it's effective is through hashtag activism. And what hashtag activism is it's simply using a hashtag to help or promote or support a specific cause on social media. So anyone who uses Twitter, Facebook, any sort of social media, basically anyone who's on the internet, is familiar with the hashtag. And so hashtag activism can be used to raise awareness around the issue. So for example, there's so many examples, but like the Black Lives Matter movement, you can think about the Arab Spring uprisings in the Middle East, you know, going all the way back to like the Occupy Wall Street movement. All this stuff started, not necessarily with a hashtag, but with, you know, raising awareness online. And I guess detractors would say that hashtag activism, it doesn't really work because it's all talk, no action. But I think, I would agree that to some extent there has to be action with the hashtag. You have to take action in addition to advocating and putting your, letting people know what causes you support. But I think this is an important foundation to getting movements started. And so this is just a stat I found from Tone Communications. They're like a research firm who look at social media impacts on American society. They found that 58% of Americans feel that tweeting or posting information about a social or environmental initiative on their social channels is an effective form of advocacy or support. And I would agree with that. I think it's definitely an important foundation to any sort of advocacy. And so being online, being connected, using digital methods also allows organizations like CESOS to sustain themselves, to fundraise, to raise money. This is another stat from that same research. It's found that if Americans have $10 give or donate online, they would give to NRC, but 47% would give to a nonprofit organization. That's overwhelmingly more than like giving to an individual or even giving to like a major corporation. So for CESOS, digitizing and reaching out to people through digital methods can be an important source of sustaining the organization and getting their message. And it also found that more than half, 53% of social media users who also have donated money or volunteered their time say that active social media presence is an important motivator for them when deciding on the type of organization to support. I think that's important because it sort of legitimizes the organization in the eyes of social media users and everyone. And lastly, these methods help you to build a community. Obviously, there's a lot of talk about online communities that exist, and I think that these tools can help sort of bridge the gap between online communities and actual communities, people in the community. It's an effective way to organize people and to get the message out. And so nearly 9 in 10, 87% of internet users say they keep up with local community news online, yet only 37% of social media users say they follow community charitable groups through those channels. I think what this kind of shows is that while people are getting their news for like local community news online, small organizations haven't necessarily capitalized on social media in terms of reaching out to people, finding new members, and things like that. So I think there's still work to be done in that. And so lastly, the last sort of digital method that I want to talk about is it's sort of near and dear to me as a historian, and that's the use of digital archives. And so as a historian, archives are kind of like bread and butter of what we do. You go out to the archive or the library or the museum or whatever, you go through the documents, the books, you sift through them, you analyze it, and then you tell a story. And I think this is digitizing archives for an organization like CESOS is so important because it's created by its archives by the community for the community. So these are stories. I mean, it can be anything. It can be oral histories that are recorded. You're talking about documents that are hundreds, centuries of years old, maps, all this stuff being put online so it's accessible for anyone who's interested in learning more about the Esekias in the South. And so this is another screenshot that we have from the website that's under development for the SVRAA. And so this is just an example of a map archive. So I was fortunate enough to contribute a little bit to the building of this site. And so the map archive, of course, is going to have maps of the Esekias in the South Valley. And I think that's an important tool to anyone who's interested in learning more about the Esekias. Because like for me, when I joined CESOS, when I thought of Esekias, I thought of it as a northern thing. I didn't know that there were Esekias in the South Valley. I was from Albuquerque. I didn't grow up in the South Valley. But you know, learning that these Esekias are here, there's a whole Esekia culture in the South Valley that I wasn't aware of, and the struggles that they face. Having a resource like this that anyone can go to, I think is just so valuable. This is just another example. This is just another map of another section. And so finally, I just kind of wanted to wrap up talking about the digital methodology by talking about this, in addition to having a map archive, just having a normal archive that has other materials and documents pertaining to the South Valley and the Esekias. So for instance, this document over here on the right, it's kind of hard to see. But what that is that's an agreement. It's from 1933 between, or I guess you can call it an agreement, between the MRGCE and the RMO and the Esekia. And so this was basically the point in time in 1933 when the MRGCE took control, I guess you can say, of the Esekias. And so I think you can see how important a document like that is in contextualizing the situation that exists today in South Africa, where it's a continued struggle over the use of water and things like that. You know, this is a pivotal document that shows that moment in history. And I think that for an organization like CESOS to have an archive like this is just so valuable, not only for members of the community, but for new members or outsiders like myself who want to be involved and who want to learn more, but don't necessarily know how to go about it. And so just to wrap up, I think all these digital methods are important ways to preserve, promote, and educate, particularly the archives. I just think that is such an invaluable tool. These tools can also be used to raise awareness to issues affecting the community. And lastly, it's an important source of knowledge controlled by members of the community to the benefit.